way, today we're going to talk about one of my favorite topics in statistics called experimental design.
Tell me more.
So experimental design basically tells us how do we design experiments, and we design experiments to see if something works. A lot of times researchers want to know, does something work? And that something could be a drug, it could be an advertising campaign, it could be a vaccine, it could be an educational method. And so to start off with experimental design, usually you have a group of subjects in your study and you want to divide them into two groups. We're going to call this a treatment and a control group. So let's just say I have 100 subjects and I want to design an experiment and divide them into one group who gets my treatment and then another group who doesn't.
What do we call these groups?
So the first group, the one that gets the treatment, we're actually going to call the treatment group. Easy enough, right?
So if we're talking about a pill or a medicine, that would be somebody who gets the pill.
Exactly, yes. If we're talking about a pill, that would be the people who actually take the drug.
And what's the other group?
And the other group is going to be called the control group. And that word control, you've probably heard it before, but it's not necessarily the same thing as you hear in regular English. Control group in this case actually means comparison group. So this is a group of people who do not get the treatment. So the key in any experimental design is that we want to make our treatment and control groups as alike as possible at the beginning of the study, so that at the end of the study, if there's a difference, we know that the treatment really did cause whatever response we see.
So how would we do that? How do we just separate the 100 subjects into the two groups?
That's a great question. So there's actually a bunch of different ways that we can do that. And I'll talk about a couple common ones. We can think about the pros and cons of them. So the first common way that I've seen in experimental design is to have the researcher, whoever's designing the study, kind of try and use that idea of making the groups as alike as possible.
So they're the expert. That makes a lot of sense. They're going to know what to look for in different groups.
Right. They're going to take everything they know about their subjects and just kind of try and make two groups that are as alike as possible.
So method one is the researcher chooses.
Yes. Method one is, we can even write these down. So method one is the researcher chooses. And if we think about the cons of this method, so a lot of times humans actually have biases that they aren't even aware of. Do you agree with that, Wes?
Yeah, there's probably some things I might be biased towards.
Yeah, exactly. So a lot of times, even though the researcher is trying to make the groups as alike as possible, they might have these unconscious biases that kind of sneak in when they're dividing the groups and make them not, they're still going to be alike, but not maybe as alike as possible. Another method is, this actually isn't a good one, but I've seen this done before, is that if the researcher thinks that their drug is going to help someone. So let's use an example. Let's say that I'm a researcher and I have a drug that I think is going to help you become better at computer science.
I want this already.
So do I. I need it. But I'm testing it out. I want to know, does it work? So technically before the experiment, that's my hypothesis, but I don't know if that's the case. So as the researcher, I could say, well, I'm going to give the people in my study that are really bad at computer science, I'm going to give them my drug because I think it works. And then give the people who are really good at it, not give them the drug. But this could backfire if my drug doesn't work. It might actually have the opposite result. So that's a really bad way to do it because, again, you can't go based on your hypothesis. So I'll call that one, this method would be I guess it kind of is the same thing. The researcher chooses in the best interest of the subjects. I'm going to say the best interest, or what they think is the best interest of the subjects. So I'm actually going to put that in quotes. Wade, can you think of any other ways?
So think about this pill. Like, I know I want to take this pill. So can we just ask all of our 100 participants if they want to take the pill or not?
That is actually a super common one as well. The researchers can decide that they are going to let their subjects choose. And thinking about the pros and cons, this is good because people like choice, right? Maybe they don't trust me. Maybe they don't want to take my drug. And so if I force them to do that, that wouldn't be that great. But what about the cons? Would this make the groups as alike as possible?
There's probably going to be some bias of people who are more comfortable taking drugs or more comfortable wanting the treatment, or people like me who want to be really great at computer science.
Exactly. So when subjects choose, there's bound to be differences between the two groups. So if we think about that main goal of keeping our treatment and control groups as alike as possible, there's a bunch of ways to divide the subjects. These are just a couple, but the best way is actually to use, I'm going to make this our number four, a random method, or to do this randomly.
So how would you even do that without having you deciding or the subjects decide?
Yeah, so this one is actually, the pros are that this is the method that's the most likely to make the groups as alike as possible, because as long as you have enough subjects, random differences are going to average out if we randomly divide subjects into a treatment and control group. You asked, how do we do this? So back in the day, they used to flip a coin to do this, but now we have tools like Python that can easily do this for us. And so this method is definitely best, but it does have a couple cons. I guess there are some things that can be problematic, such as a lot of times these are very difficult to do because you have to get volunteers who are basically willing to be in either the treatment or control group. Oftentimes the random method is expensive because people, if they're going to have, they're not going to know which group they're in, they want to get paid. I know when I'm in studies, I like to get paid. So keeping that in mind, this is definitely best, but there are some cons that come with it as well.
And one last question. You mentioned that it had to be a large enough group for random control trials to work well.
Yes.
So what would you do if you didn't quite get enough people to have a great random control trial?
That is a great question. So the more subjects we have, the better, because then our groups, the randomization is going to make pretty similar groups. But if we, a lot of times if we have a really small sample size, sometimes even if you randomly divide the subjects, you might get different groups kind of just by chance if there's not enough people. So we can use a technique in statistics called blocking that we're going to talk about in great detail throughout this series, but that can help with the small sample size.
Sounds great.
And then the last thing I want to say about experimental design is, you might be wondering, okay, why does this matter? Why do we need to randomly divide our subjects? And the key is that at the end of the study, so if we start out with having our treatment and control group as alike as possible, so I'm going to kind of draw a diagram here with balance scales. This is how I like to represent this. So say this is our treatment group, this is our control group, and they are about equal. They're as alike as possible. If we have this at the beginning of the study, and then at the end of the study, let's say with the computer science drug that throughout the semester, the students take the drug, and then at the end of the study, we measure how they did in a computer science class, and we see that they're no longer balanced. Like, say we see something like, let's see, how do I draw this? Something like this, where the treatment group did a lot better than the control group, then we can attribute this difference to the treatment itself. We can say that our drug actually worked, and that's a really powerful thing when we want to know, does something work?
We can only make that conclusion if our original groups were actually equal.
Yes, and the best way to do that is to randomly divide them. So that is a bit of experimental design, and we are definitely going to talk more about this throughout the series.
Awesome.